Bloody pleasant Sunday morning to you. Pleasant Sunday morning to you, Sharmain. How are you today?
Sober. Reflective.
Yes. Concerned and reflective. I understand. Yes. It's a tough place where we are. Welcome inside what we call Brunch from 107.7. Thank you so much for choosing us. We are with you all the way up until 12 o'clock. A number of issues at hand. We will be dealing with the internet and the question of politics, the issue of how do we control that if we can. We will be looking at the volcano called Kick'em Jenny. Sharmain will be talking to Lloyd Lynch from the University of the West Indies. He's actually on his way from Grenada to St. Vincent advising governments on that, so we get a chance to do that too. I trust that your week was a good one outside of being in a reflective mood this morning, Sharmain. Was the week, I think it was a bounty for you. You are the head of news, so when you look around, you're not exactly happy at what's happening, but there is a lot to discuss.
There is a lot to discuss, but at the end of the day, there's something, there's an article that I read just about a month or two ago, post-traumatic stress disorder. So those of us who are out there, and hardly any of us are on the front line, but a lot of other reporters are actually in the front line looking at dead bodies, hearing gunshots, and the fear-mongering that prevailed over the week, and that is going into an election, and we've got a long way ahead of us before this election, is indeed cause for concern.
You of course know that voice. That is Sharmain Baboolal. I did not introduce myself. I am Rennie Bishop. We are here. Our guest this morning, Sharmain, is Inspector Anand Ramesar. He's the president of the Trinidad and Tobago Police Social and Welfare Association. And I will take that down for you in a moment. Let us say good morning to the inspector. Thank you so much for joining us, sir. Inspector, oh, there you go. I think I actually hit a switch that did not bring me the inspector. One of the areas, I think, when you talk of trauma, Sharmain, has to do with what happened on Thursday.
Friday morning.
On Friday morning, I apologize. Yes, thank you.
Yeah.
And looking at that for the citizenry, tell us, what is your take as to what actually occurred? What is your take as to what had occurred? Because I was concerned when I heard the police commissioner saying, the hierarchy of the police department saying that we knew of this, something like this could happen, and we put measures in place, i.e. we increased the security in different places to deal with it. I was a bit surprised that they could just walk out. I was a bit surprised that they could just walk out in the way they did. I mean, they came shooting their way. I'm not gonna make this sound easy. They came shooting their way out. But still was a little disturbed that they were able to get that much more than just a block away from where this happened.
Well, not that they were able to get a block away. In the first instance, the good news of Friday morning was that Mr. Hackett, police assistant police commissioner, letting us know that they knew, they had a hint that this was going to happen. So the good news is that, hey, Mr. Ramesar, please come back on the line and help us out. Special Branch is indeed working. Because Special Branch clearly did not know anything about the day of policing, which shut down the entire country. So the good news is that Special Branch apparently would have reported to them.
Mm-hmm.
And then we heard again yesterday on the radio via the police commissioner, who thanked all the people who helped him to bring in the accused for the murder of Dana Sitahal. The Special Branch was part of it as well. So Special Branch is indeed working. So let's start off on a good note.
All right, let us know better note than to start with the president of the Police Social and Welfare Association. Mr. Ramesar, thank you so much for joining us again.
My pleasure. Thank you very much for inviting me.
All right, we just lost you for a moment. The first instance we want to ask you is to respond to the situation with the jailbreak. Many people are saying after the arrest of Abu Bakr and the anticipated reaction, justified or not, that was, the national security mobilization was inadequate, it seems to, because these prisoners were not only able to breach the situation of the Royal Jail, but to get more than just a one-block radius getaway, with all of this culminating, unfortunately, at the Port of Spain General Hospital. Speak to that for me, please, sir.
Well, in the first instance, I want to extend condolences to the family of Officer Maynard, who lost his life as a result of what transpired at the prison in relation to that jailbreak. You know, the police service as a body, we are deeply in grief by what would have transpired. And, you know, police officers are standing in solidarity. And we are doing a lot of inner searching in terms of how we treat with the welfare of our membership. But dealing with the issue at hand, coming out of the jailbreak, there are a lot of questions that need to be answered. And one of the things for us is that in the first instance, is that the personnel at the prisons, they need to be held accountable. Clearly, you must have a criminal investigation with great dispatch that needs to be done very quickly. Because you can't have a situation where a policeman has lost his life coming out of a security breach that should not have happened, especially in that particular context. And I know you mentioned the situation about the arrest of Mr. Abubakar and whether or not there's a connection. The police service has not made that connection. Mm. But one of the things that you have to be mindful of is that you always had to be on the alert, because, given who he is and what were the concerns of members of the public. Because one of the things that drives police in is the concerns of the members, whether it is real or whether it is perceived. It is a duty on the part of the police service to put things in place to ensure that the perception of crime is reduced. So, for me, the police service too has a question to answer in relation to what was taking place between that arrest and in relation to what transpired at the remand yard.
Just for clarity, when I did make the reference to Abubakar, I was specifically saying the anticipated reaction, justified or not. I just said that there was an anticipation of a reaction. I was not, in fact, making a link. I know there was just an environment that something could happen. So folks were talking in the context of a heightened alertness. Is that area that I made the link. Sharmain?
Mr. Ramesar, good morning. How are you?
Good morning. I'm fine. Thank you very much.
Please don't misinterpret any line of questioning that's going to come here now as anything against the police service, because they are hard questions that need to be answered by the people, and we're coming up from the ground here. First, let us clarify what is the scope of a police investigation into what happened in the prison. Can the police go into the prison to investigate, or is the prison investigating itself and then coming out with a report which the police will handle? So let's handle that first.
The police service has a primary role to play in relation to investigation. Regardless of where a crime occurs in Trinidad and Tobago, no one has the authority but the police service to carry out that investigation in relation to determine whether there is some criminal act which would have taken place and whether there are persons who are responsible and should be brought before a court of law. The prison service is entitled to carry out its own investigation in relation to understanding what went wrong as an organization, and also has a responsibility to identify where the shortcomings and who or what persons in the employ would have, whether negligent or otherwise, would have contributed to it, and deal with them swiftly.
Okay, granted that we heard nothing from the police commissioner yesterday about, nothing really substantial about the prison or an investigation into what happened. All right, therefore, can you say what between Friday and this morning have the police done in getting in? What have they done? Have they gone into the prison? What has happened?
I cannot confirm if the police service has done anything. What I can say, if they haven't done anything, then again, they have a question to answer, because at the end of the day, the commissioner of police has lost a police officer who was doing his duty, nothing else other than carrying out his function as delegated to him by the commissioner of police. So the commissioner of police not only has a duty to do in relation to how he treats with crime, he has a responsibility in relation to that policeman from an internal aspect of the organization to ensure that some closure is brought to that matter.
On a wider national scale, beyond just losing one member of the police service, which we are all saddened about, because clearly he was innocent, he was just there. Before we ask, there are two things. My mind is racing because of all the things that are in my head. One, I want to ask for someone to explain, because we have not yet explained, and I've heard PC Sherman Maynard's mother ask, what are the circumstances under which her son was shot? Where was he? Was he at that shootout in the hospital? Because that's where we heard those guys, from the footage that we've seen, came out of the prison shooting. right? But there, we don't see anybody falling at the time. Then we heard different reports. One report says that he was shot while he was in a patrol vehicle. And then we're trying to figure out, was he shot during that exchange of gunfire up at the hospital? At what point was he shot and killed?
Ma'am, the information which has come to the association is that he was on patrol. And he, whilst on patrol, he would have been in the vicinity where one of the getaway cars would have incurred an accident. And arising out of that, shots were fired, and he would have been fatally wounded. I know that there are other theories associated with it, information coming that is conflicted and cannot be reconciled with that, what I have said. But my information at this point in time, into what would have transpired, is in relation to him being on patrol, as I just mentioned.
All right, so we're not linking anything because I'm not in a position and I don't have information to make these links. But there are things that have happened. We go back to Crown Trace in the middle of Ramadan, having all these incidents that grabbed news headlines for a couple of days. Then we fast forward to this incident, at least, and even before that, well, the detention of Baka, which, of course, we are told it was in relation to questioning for Dina Sital's murder. We come to this incident, this jailbreak, and then there are three Muslim men, young or old, and then we come to the arrest of 11 men, most of whom are Muslims, right? There is and has been for the past 2 years people in very reputable positions talking and warning about the ISIS element. There are people who would have traveled outside, returned to Trinidad with that military mind, that extra killer instinct, that the jail is a breeding ground for extremists. What? Why isn't the police giving us the impression that they are on top of this situation and that we are getting, what we're getting is this morning, photos splattered all over the newspapers between Saturday morning and this morning of Hassan Atwell this morning and Alan Scanny Martin on yesterday morning. And is that how you all, that does not give an assurance that, listen, well, police are dealing with this ISIS situation or this ISIS-themed situation because there is a lot out there to come?
Well, in the first instance, there is a lot of information in relation to ISIS. I can say for sure that the police service is responding to what is suspected of taking place to the extent that we have put in place an anti-terrorist unit. That would have been implemented recently. In addition to that, the police service must say whether or not its intelligence failed or whether its intelligence had brought the information to them in relation to the prison break. This is not a prison break where somebody would have overpowered a guard, a prison officer, so to speak. This is more than that. This is about a hand grenade. We're talking about small arms. We're talking about persons being shot. We're talking about arms getting inside the prison. And you know they come under the Ministry of Justice, but in every essence, they are about national security because they deal with criminal elements. And it wouldn't be sufficient even for the police to just do an investigation. You know, an investigation would just scratch the surface. You need to do a proper inquiry into what is taking place at the prisons. In the light of what you are saying, whether or not it may or may not be a breeding ground for persons to be recruited into terrorist groups or otherwise, or any group that may have an intention to carry out crimes. But clearly, you need to go back to the prisons, and you have to listen to the prison association as well. They have been complaining for quite a while in terms of the overcrowding at the prisons. So these are not things that you can just deal in isolation. No. You have to look at the whole picture in terms of the challenges at the state prisons, the challenges of the prison officers, and you have to look at it in terms of the policing. How is policing being affected in terms of persons who go into the remand yard, and what are they exposed to?
The president of the Police Social and Welfare Association, Anand Ramesar, is our guest. If you look at what happened here and look at some of the videotape of the cable TV that was done, you know, internally, that's within the walls of the prison, what you see are three men running out. My question is the same as is on the lips of a number of the public. don't they have the mechanisms in place, i.e. 1, 2, and 3 layer stop areas between the prison, the visiting area, and the front of the remand yard of the prison? Because the problem is, if they started shooting at one point, there was nothing, it seemed, that stopped them. Now, I didn't never want any officer of the country to be shot. I mean, you know, the protective service. But you did not have a lot of resistance, it seemed, happening inside the walls. That must be surely a case of concern for you.
Well, again, I don't want to cast any aspersions on the prison officers who worked on that particular day, but clearly there is a question that needs to be answered from the prison service in relation to what went wrong, because they are charged with a responsibility. They are trained to carry out that particular responsibility. And clearly, we are reasonable in our expectations to say that if they had carried out their responsibility in the manner in which they would have been trained, that the incident of that happening was not likely.
One of the areas of major concern, too, is the question of panic that resulted of this, because we had social media going awry. That's an area we will talk about a little later on. But, you know, had a lot of folks getting their information that way. I thought there would have been a central body, an authority somewhere, to grab the horns, as it were, and make clear to the public what was going on in the shortest possible time, cognizant of the impact of social media. We did not find that happening.
Well, that would normally fall under the National Operations Center.
Mm-hmm.
And again, they have to indicate in terms of what was their information and what went wrong. But again, when you look at the impact, because when you see what took place throughout Port of Spain, there was a lot of widespread panic in some instances. And I know for a fact that a lot of businesses allow their employees to leave early. And then you had the traffic jam and all these things. So these things suggest that people were worried about their safety, and they felt that they were better off leaving Port of Spain. So for me, in terms of the role of the National Operations Center in one and disseminating information to the public, did not appear to have been effectively carried out.
Does it mean that the National Operations Center should preempt the police commissioner, or can he independently hold a news conference or issue a statement, there is no need for panic, please calm out? And if the police commissioner says this, it should have some credibility?
Well, in any event, the National Operations Center is not a body that is independent, so to speak. It relies on networking with the security organizations in Trinidad and Tobago. But normally in a situation like this, the person who would take command should be the Commissioner of Police for all intents and purposes. With the emergence of the National Operations Center, they now operate in terms of getting that information and networking a response. I know they had the choppers out and these other things. So somewhere along the line, in terms of what the police was doing and what the National Operations Center should have produced a response for the public to tell the public whether or not it is a situation where we have under control or we need further assistance. But the fact of the matter is that you had persons who were large, who were on the run, sorry, and they were armed and they were dangerous because they started off by killing a policeman.
Mm.
And in that context, the members of the public in the first instance would have been reasonable in making a decision to get out of Port of Spain, as far as I am concerned.
And because, you see, not only the confusion among the citizenry is the reason I pointed the question to you, as president of the Police Welfare Association, you would appreciate that confusion makes life a lot harder for your folks to secure the nation, to carry about their work. And as such, I would expect that your association will make a demand that in the case of we have this be part of the contingency plan should we have another emergency or situation developing like this, because it endangers the citizenry, but it also hampers and present a risk for your officers, does it not?
Well, that is a clear requirement, given that the role that communication is playing in national security. As I said, it is a role that has normally been utilized mostly by the National Operations Center. But, you know, my mind just goes back to one particular incident in all of this. Because we have asked the question in terms of whether perception or otherwise, were we prepared for this? And I know the Minister of National Security also needs to answer a question. Because I think a few days before, he would have gone public and tried to allay the fears of the public and say, you know, we do not have any incident of anything happening that might cause the public safety to be compromised.
Mm-hmm.
So in relation to that, I am saying the movement in terms of the introduction of the firearm into the prison and the subsequent prison break of police officers are being shot, men, fugitives at large, is not something that would have happened ad hoc.
Okay.
Something that happened by way of opportunity. Clearly, okay. It was planned. Clearly, this is something that the intelligence in relation to national security has a question to answer, whether they had the information before and what did they do. And if they did not have the information, then people apparently aren't doing their job properly.
Okay, so let's kind of break this down. So we're hearing Hackett saying on Friday that there were police officers stationed outside the prisons because they had word, mm-hmm. right, which is why we are saying, and that would have come, I suppose, from Special Branch, which is your intelligence unit, or unless you have another intelligence unit that we're not privy to, a private one, the information would have come that they were expecting something in the prisons, okay? That information, clearly, based on what you are saying now, that the National Security Minister a few days before allayed fears and said there is nothing to be worried about, was obviously not given to him. Mr. Alfonso does not walk the ground. Mr. Alfonso depends on his troops and his people to tell him what is going on. So if indeed the police did not get that information to the higher authorities, yet they acted on it, right? Police acted on it, but the National Security Minister is not aware that the police is acting on information that is possibly going to be a jailbreak or some disturbance at a prison, given the history of recent history in the prison that we've been discussing on this program here a lot. And I want to take that, just one last thing. I'd been waiting to ask you this question as well. You're talking about communication between the police commissioner and the National Operations Center. So we're seeing that there is no communication, there is lack of communication, there's no coordination, should be the word.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? In the long years that I've been doing this job as a journalist, we've always had a police commissioner or someone call a news conference, as they did yesterday, and say, look, this is happening, this is not happening. In the case, we've had three wanted men out there. We have three wanted men out there. Well, one now.
Yeah.
One was shot dead immediately within an hour of leaving the prison, mm-hmm. right? We did not get an official statement from the police saying that until much later, but images that clearly could have come because police would have been privy to the crime scene. People were running away from where Scani was shot in that hospital guard boot, unless there was a guard there and he was brave enough to pull out his phone and take those photos. So those photos were circulating. One, this morning, we all woke up to news breaking on the Beyond the Tape Facebook page. Mm-hmm. News is breaking that Hassan Atwell was shot last night. It did not come from the police commissioner giving a statement. It did not come via an official release from the news, from the police. So what is happening? Who is in charge? Who's doing what? What's happening?
Well, again, for me, the commissioner will have to answer a question in relation to that breakdown. Or even if you don't want to describe it as a breakdown, the context in which the information has been would have been given to the public could have been much better. Beyond the Tape is a program that the Commissioner of Police is responsible for, but it cannot be the primary medium of communication to the members of the public in relation to something as serious as the jailbreak, because, as you have rightly stated, in the past, commissioners of police or their deputy commissioners of police would address the public by way of a press conference. And just as we did the press conference in relation to the Sita Hall's matter, you clearly must know that it would have been your responsibility to do a press conference. Now, in relation to the death of one of the fugitives. But it cannot be a situation where you think you didn't have the information, but the information is now coming out via Beyond the Tape.
And
again, that is another area in terms of communication, and the dispersion of information has to be reevaluated, and the shortcomings must be addressed.
Anand Ramesar, the president of the Police Social and Welfare Association, is our guest this morning on Brunch. I'm Rennie Bishop. My co-host is Sharmain Baboolal. As of this moment, to the best of your knowledge, what is going on with this search for the one remaining person?
Well, we have to be guided by the Commissioner of the Police. The Commissioner has made a public call. He has given a mandate to all police officers. We are using every information that we have, both past, present, and present. But there is an island-wide response in relation to these fugitives.
And people are asking that you hope that at least they bring in one of the three alive, the last one, so that at least dead men tell no tales. So how can we begin to investigate what went on in the prison if you don't bring in one of these guys alive to say what happened? Or is it deliberate that they all been out there and no man is coming in alive? And that's the end of it. That's what we're going to hear about it. That's the end of it, because there is so much more.
It will be most unfortunate if we don't get answers to what transpired in relation to the jailbreak. And I cannot say whether or not in capturing the fugitive, what would be the circumstances. Police officers will have to protect themselves. The fugitive is suspected to be armed and dangerous, and police officers will approach the situation with much caution. One of the things that could assist us in getting answers is if members of the public give us information so we can plan in terms of how we capture the person. If the intelligence comes about, is one that we can rely on. But clearly, as I said, it will be unfortunate if this matter comes to a close without these questions being answered, because I think it's both inside and outside of the prisons. Questions have to be answered.
But absent this last person coming in alive, surely a proper investigation into what took place with the process within the prison will bring us the answers. Some heads must roll in that area, because it's clear. It's not a variable. It's not a fluctuating. It's not a dynamic situation. These are the processes in place. Should so and so happen in the visiting room? Should so and so happen from a prison break? And onwards. I mean, there is a way for us to find out, one, how these guns got in there in the first place, and the hand grenade. I mean, from the investigation, we must find out, and some people must be held accountable on this. Would you not agree?
Well, I agree with you, but I think that the fugitive would be one of your best witnesses in all of this.
Exactly. And if they don't bring in one alive, then there's clearly much, much more in the mortar than the pestle, Mr. Ramesar. Yeah.
I will have my own perception, which I wouldn't voice on air, but clearly, as I said, the fugitive clearly would be one of your best witnesses.
It is my hope that we can get you back in short order, because there are a number of other areas. This one, of course, many things are important. This one was more immediate, and I thank you for being candid with us on it. But there are a number of issues, i.e. guns in courtrooms, police salaries, the industrial court, and all these issues. Also, the issue of trust between the citizenry and the police. These are things I would like to have discussed with you, and as such, I'm putting out the invitation for you now to come in here at the studio with us in short order.
Well, you have my number, and I'm always willing to talk on matters affecting the police service.
Going to take advantage of that. I thank you so much for taking the time to be with us this morning, sir.
And thank you very much. And we know it's trying time for you and your colleagues in the police service as well, but it's national duty.
It is, and thank you all very much.
You're welcome.